Safe will come to order. Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Counsel Dion? Counsel Washington?
Here.
Chairman Kilby?
Here. Pursuant to the open meeting law, any person may make a video or audio recording of this public meeting and may transmit the meeting through any medium. Attendees are therefore advised that such recordings and transmissions are being made whether perceived or unperceived by those present and are deemed acknowledged and permissible. So, citizen input is number one. Madam Clerk?
We have one written that was sent in.
Please read that.
From CJ Ferry.
You have a microphone.
The citizen input is from CJ Ferry, 300 Buffington Street. It says, regarding the realignment of EMS services. I would like to express my concerns regarding the EMS realignment that has been proposed by the mayor, the fire, and EMS chiefs. The removal of EMS equipment from neighborhoods places some citizens' safety in jeopardy. While it has been argued that there will be no increase in response times, I can tell you that if an EMS vehicle leaves Bedford Street Station at 3, 4, or 5 in the afternoon, you can be sure that there will be delays in getting through the traffic, especially on Bedford Street, Pleasant Street, and Plymouth Avenue. During peak times, these streets and several others are jam-packed with vehicles, and it makes it almost impossible to navigate the streets. I can tell you from experience that the EMS equipment from the Niagara Station has on more than one occasion responded in a rapid fashion. The speed of the response in my situation is necessary to prevent an exacerbation of my health condition that could result in coma or death. When other vehicles have responded from other parts of the city, the delay was noticeable and has resulted in a few instances in hospitalization. Please emphasize to the administration and to the fire and EMS chiefs the concern that is presented by the neighborhoods and users of their service. Response times are one of the most important factors in critical care issues with EMS. If EMS is delayed by a minute or two, someone could die or suffer irreparable harm. The duty of the city and our elected officials is to protect the citizens of the city. This realignment is not protecting the safety of the people of Fall River. Respectfully, CJ Ferry. This citizen input was for the regular meeting this evening?
No, I believe it was for public safety.
That was not the intent of the book. This is for the regular meeting. Was anyone here for a citizen input for the public safety meeting?
Yes, and there's three.
So you will not be speaking at finance, is that correct?
It's on the issue before us.
So you're coming for citizen input for public safety and not for the regular meeting? Okay. First individual?
Thank you, counselors, and I apologize, I didn't see a sign-up sheet. And before I start my comments, I do want to give you understanding. I understand there's new leadership, and I understand this public safety subcommittee has been rearranged, so just take my comments generally. And again, good afternoon, counselors. I, like many others, believe this public safety subcommittee should reprioritize and focus on its future, not tonight, but on its future agendas. Items focusing, one, on the uptick in this illegal ATV use, and to address the uptick in violent crime we've seen in this community over the last few weeks, and I would even say the last few years. I am someone who believes words matter. Reactions to events matter. And the responses of our elected leaders are crucial to this morale of the public. I think we move forward when our leaders take a strong stance on issues, not when the administration of our city remains silent in the wake of an ATV attack on a police officer. I don't think responding many days later on a radio show was the appropriate answer. I don't think we move forward when we have a public safety committee that stood dormant for many months, when I guess the only issue of public safety in Fall River was decibel noise from a car wash. I don't think we're doing the community any justice when we discuss small issues such as that. We need leadership from all our elected officials. I think we need to show strength. We need to show the community that we care about public safety and that these issues matter to us. I don't think we need a strong leadership, and I don't think we should avoid discussing the issues, and again, this is general, hoping they go away because the administration is scared of bad press. And I hope going forward at these next meetings in the city council in general, we show the community these issues do matter to them. Thank you.
Thank you.
So you will not be speaking at finance?
I will not.
Mm-hmm. Next person for citizen input? John?
Sure. Yeah, John Sylvia, 51 Ada Street.
Good afternoon, John.
Good afternoon. I'm here. There, it's on the agenda about the ambulances at Niagara Station. But I have spoke with Seth, and he is going to come to our next neighborhood meeting next Monday to discuss this, so we can get more information on it. That's really the only thing. I know Helen has a petition of folks.
Can you speak in the microphone, please?
Yeah, sorry. She has a petition of folks that, that don't want the ambulance taken from Niagara Station. But like I said, we're having a meeting, next week. So hopefully that'll resolve it.
Okay, thank you.
Yep.
So I hope today we're going to get some answers in terms of response time, which is the issue.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, and thanks.
Thank you.
John, will you be speaking at finance also?
No.
Next individual?
Yes.
Nelson?
Is that your pleasure?
Good morning. Oh, good morning. Good afternoon. Good evening. Sorry. So I was in disbelief today when I seen an interview from the police chief, basically perpetuating the same line that we're a safe community. But in January of 2021, the FBI Uniform Crime Reporting Statistics, UCR for short, transitioned to a national incident-based reporting system. And basically, it provides a more detailed incident-based data. And the reason why this new system, NIBRS for short, here are the benefits of it. It provides greater specificity in reporting offenses, collects more detailed information, helps give context to specific crime problems, and provides greater analytic flexibility. So, and all the counselors received this by email, all this information. And according to this article, after gathering the information from what I just read, we are number one as the most dangerous city in the state of Massachusetts. For this line going around that we're the most safe city, it's, according to the FBI, it's the total opposite. I think what needs to happen is that this administration needs to come down to reality and tell the people what it is and start telling the people that we're safe, but we're not. I mean, he likes to hide from problems and doesn't like to address it head on, but when you have the FBI saying the opposite of what he's saying every single day, that's a problem. People take the words of elected officials seriously, and he won't challenge the FBI's statistics. He won't do that. I mean, you can point to other websites, but this here, I made it specific to get the information from FBI.gov about what the system is and what is it entails. So I think Paul needs to come out of the closet, stop hiding from the problems, tell the people what it is, and handle this ATV problem. Because to see a police officer get dragged live on camera, I mean, that to me, it should have never gone this far. It's time for him to be real to people and take action, because his inaction is costing the city, and it's not a good look. Thank you.
I have a question.
Yes.
Mr. Voss.
You can make it. Okay, Laura, go ahead. I usually don't allow, but it's okay.
Go ahead. What just want the date of the article?
This was,
I'm sorry.
It was 11 days ago that this was posted. It says, when you click on it.
I thought you said 2001.
No. The system was it was transitioned back in January of 2021. Mm-hmm. That's when this new reporting system came. Okay. the transition came that the FBI did. But as for this article here, it keeps a timer. It was like 11 days ago.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Sorry about that.
Nelson, will you be speaking at the Committee on Finance?
Name and address, please.
Good evening.
Not that anyone don't know you.
Tom Corey, 477 Sherman Street, Fall River. So I'm here to address public safety, just to put on the radar for the city council to understand that the roadway between Locust Street and New Boston Road, the stretch on Northeastern Avenue, has been exceedingly dangerous for years and years and years. We all know that there's been so many accidents detailed there, some even resulting in death. Some resulting in trees down and power lines down. So many people tend to disregard the safety speed limit on that stretch because there's no light or anything to inhibit their speed between Locust and New Boston Road. So it becomes a real straight dragway. And I'm not talking just ATVs. I know that's the latest issue that people are grappling with. I'm talking about cars and motorcycles that drive super fast to the point where it's extremely dangerous. We've had neighborhood meetings. Thankfully, the Bank Street neighborhood hosted a meeting with the police and the mayor. So we've gotten our point of view out already. But I'm here tonight to address public safety with you, the city councilors, and hopefully to maybe put your heads together and pay attention to an ongoing issue on Northeastern Avenue for high speed and dangerous speed. It really does need attention. People have been kicking the can down the road. I've spoken to state delegation. I've spoken to different city councilors through the years. But really, I think right now is the time to focus. We're already in ambulance route, so we get our host of sirens throughout the day rushing to the hospital. That's a given. That's fine. You know, it's all the in-between stuff, and especially when the schools get out of session and the teenagers are revving their cars on the avenue. So the late afternoons, the mid to late afternoons are dangerous. And in the summer, spring and summer, night times are extremely dangerous. There's a real lot of fast travel there. So thank you for having me here. I just wanted to get that point of view out.
Thank
I appreciate
you.
It. Thank you.
Who are you looking to speak at? Finance?
No.
Thank you.
Is that all?
That's all we have tonight.
Thank you for everyone coming down to speak. Citizens' input is it's all points well taken, and we'll I'm sure Laura and I will keep it into deep consideration. So, item number two. No, I should talk about the ATV issue. I talked to the chief. He has a comprehensive plan that he's working on. And it's definitely on the radar of this committee. I live 1846 Robeson Street, right down the street from where the accident happened. And it was horrific. It could, as many things, it could have been a lot worse than what it was. So it is definitely a huge issue going into March for sure. So we'll continue with the agenda. Item number two is the minutes from June 28, 2022.
Motion to adopt.
Motion to adopt the minutes. I'll second that. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? So voted. Number three, resolution discussion regarding ways to improve resident safety regarding speeding on within Northeastern Avenue and Bedford Street, referred on 11-8-22. So we have, who do we have here? Administration. And we have officers from the Fort Police Department. You're welcome to come down, please. And I believe the sponsor for this resolution was Councilor Pereira. I don't want any more open meeting law violations, but yes, you come down as a citizen, you live in the area? Absolutely.
Thank you.
So we'll, hi, welcome, Michelle Dan. So, yeah, let's let Council Perez speak on the resolution first, and we'll hear from the law enforcement officials.
The reason that I filed the resolution was because, as you know, I live in that area, and I've gotten numbers of calls from people in the area, even, you know, attending different activities over at St. Anthony of the Desert. Many people that live around that area have complained. I did notice that the police department put up a sign last week that tells you the speed that you're going. So hopefully that will work a little. I don't know if maybe some of those flashing lights that say slow down, but in the summer it's horrific with the motorcycles and the traffic that goes by there. The noise level is out of control, that people can't even sit outside. Maybe a suggestion would be that, you know, there's a police cruiser there at certain times of the day, give people tickets so that they know they're going to get ticketed if they're doing this, and also changing the light, because they tend to want to speed from Locust Street all the way down to get that light before that light turns red. So maybe if Mr. Hathaway can change that light. I know the light has made a big difference on Eastern Avenue in Bedford. There's not as many accidents. Everybody goes at a different time. So that has been a positive. So maybe something to do with the lights. But just that, you know, I've gotten a lot of calls from people and a lot of concerns, and that's why I brought it to the attention of the council.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So as we were...
Excuse me? Oh, names, please. Thank you.
Captain Kelly Furtado, and this is Officer Tom Farris.
And what are your roles in the department?
I am the commander of the Special Operations Unit, which I'm in charge of the traffic unit that falls under my parameter. Officer Farris is the most senior person in the traffic unit and is well-versed in the issue on Eastern Avenue.
Okay, so we have the right people here.
Yes.
So,
go ahead. I hope. So as soon as the chief let us know that, you know, he received an email that there was some issues. Obviously, this happens quite often. We deploy resources to the area of a complaint, and then it dies down, right? And then it'll start back up again, and then we have to deploy again. So once we were made aware of the issue, Officer Farris put the speed trailer out. The speed trailer will tell us how many cars go by, whether they're speeding or not, the time of day, so that we can put resources in the area where, you know, say it's 8 o'clock in the morning or 9 o'clock at night. So we don't have a police officer there 8 hours during the quiet time and doesn't catch anybody, but it really should be at 10 o'clock. So this is a great tool for us. So as soon as we learned about it, we deployed it, and Officer Farris can tell you what our findings are.
And may I, how long ago was this little study done? How long is it?
This is a 6-day study that was just, we just printed out the results. I believe it's still out there, though, the traffic trailer, right?
Good, officer.
Okay.
Good evening, Thomas Farris, Forest Police Department. I'm currently assigned to the Special Operations Traffic Unit. I've been in the unit for about 10 years. Very well aware of some of the more serious issues in the city as far as speed and collisions and whatnot, and a lot of it can seem much faster than what it is. The posted speed limit on Northeastern Avenue was 40 miles per hour. That's 58 feet per second. So any car driving 58 feet per second is going to seem very fast. However, they're within the state guidelines here as far as the speed limit. What I did was I deployed the All Traffic Solutions trailer. What this trailer does is it's equipped with a radar device and the necessary software to count cars, count speed, direction travel. It's able to assess risk and compliance with whatever street you put it on. So what I did was I put it on the northbound side of Eastern Avenue. I started that study on 11/11 to 11/17, 6 days, 24-hour period, and a total volume of vehicles northbound lane only between Locust Street and New Boston Road was 38,674. Quite a lot of cars. What this program does is it breaks it down to compliance with, you know, speed limit or less, 10 miles over, 20 miles over, and high risk would be 20 plus. Starting at midnight, we have this is done hourly. Midnight, between that period, November 11th to November 17th, you had 246 cars. Four of those were high risk. In other words, 20 plus. And those numbers, just the busy times of days, I would say were anytime probably 7 a.m. till maybe about 9 o'clock at night, and those numbers change. So some of the higher numbers for vehicles, 6 a.m., 251 cars. That's 2,051 cars between midnight and 11:59 during that study period. So this is not day specific. 2,051 cars, 13 of those were high risk. 2 o'clock in the afternoon, between that period of November 11th to November 17th, 2,614 cars, 11 of those were high risk. All of the rest were within compliance or less. 3 o'clock in the afternoon, that's right between where Diamond has release, 2,550 cars, 16 were high risk. And the numbers just go from there. 4 o'clock in the afternoon, 2,291 cars, four were high risk. 5 o'clock in the afternoon, 2,352 cars, five were high risk. And then the numbers go from there. We're able to pinpoint hours where we could deploy a police officer in an attempt to educate the public on their speed. What this trailer can also do is provide us with what it's doing as far as compliance. Does the trailer work? Are people just driving blindly, not knowing that they're driving 25 miles over the speed limit? I think 25 miles over the speed limit, you should kind of know that. For some of those times, we're just about 50% amount of the cars who realize that they're above the speed limit comply. It's just about 50%. Some are 42, some are 51. So it's just about 50% where it shows that the sign is working as far as slowing cars down.
What's the definition of high risk?
High risk is 20 miles plus over the speed limit.
That. Okay. Councilor Dean?
So that'd be 60 plus.
So when you say that 50% are over, that can just be 1 mile an hour over. It's in any of the categories, basically. When you're talking about 50% of the drivers being above the speed limit?
No, 50%, the sign is recording compliance. In other words, someone driving, they could be going 43,
right,
and now they slow down to 41.
So basically, based on those numbers, the high-risk category is less than 1% of the drivers?
It might be just about there, ma'am, yes.
So the impression is that the majority are speeding, but it's actually less than 1%.
If I would crunch some numbers, I'd say that's correct.
Yeah. That's a pretty incredible result. That wouldn't have been anticipated. With that, I yield for now. Thank you.
Thank you. Less than 1%. Wow. So, Laura?
Yeah.
Counselor?
So, you identified the high traffic time, so I think if I'm correct, it's the 3 o'clock. Does that seem like you had the most cars during that time?
It was just about 3 o'clock. 3, 4, 5, 6 o'clock, about the time where people are getting out of school and
school
heading home.
And work.
Right.
Yeah.
Isn't already at home.
Yeah.
Plus you have now Eastern Avenue, obviously, Durfee, BCC, Conley, Diamond, all getting out around the same time. They all are down Eastern Avenue.
So Officer Ferris, what historically, what have you done in the past with situations like this when you have identified a time where there are the high traffic or high speeding? What have you done in the past?
In past, what we've done is we'll park on the road, we'll conduct radar and LIDAR in an attempt to educate the people. I don't think, you know, the term handing out speeding tickets, I think, is so egregious. It's just, you know.
Does it work,
that's,
though?
that's not what we're here to do. Yeah. We're here to educate the public and slow people down and keep people safe. That's our job. So what we would do is we'd post and identify vehicles traveling, you know, above the speed limit, well above the speed limit. You don't want to stop a 48 and let a 65 go by you. That's not going to fix anything. So you want more quality than quantity.
So has it worked in the past? So when you do you find that it works? The education of the...
I think what happens is when you stop a car, you're blocking the lane. So inherently, people have to slow down anyway. There comes a point on, at those times,
yeah.
Diamond letting out and between that 2:30 and 4 o'clock, it becomes congested to the point where it's not just people speeding. It could just be negligence, complete negligence. So when you're stopping cars, you're blocking a lane, you're slowing cars down anyway.
So I know that you don't like the term handing out tickets, but I think that if they, and I have no idea, but if maybe there was an enforcement of handing out tickets during that time and that work got up, maybe that would work? I mean, I don't know, but I'm just thinking some enforcement during those high traffic areas, especially if you talk about the schools, the kids coming out at that time from the high schools and the colleges. That's, you know, just a thought.
They do give out tickets. Like, they'll issue them warnings instead of a monetary amount of money because it is quite hefty.
I yield.
Thank you. To piggyback, Councilor Warren, Washington's comment. We do have the new Diamond coming online in a couple of years. So, I mean, was there any thought, maybe Seth can answer this question, or any thought to doing something similar what we're doing at Durfee High School? And that in the intersection I think people have been talking about is Locust Street and Eastern Avenue. So is it, I mean, during those peak hours where people are flying, you know, is it, doable to, I know we're doing the lines and, you know, the crosswalks, and I see a lot of that going on, but is it feasible to get something done in terms of having officers, because I drive by Durfee every day, I drive Beeson Avenue every day, and I see speeding, of course, and it's, I'm older, so I, you know, I have my car, I keep the, I look at the monitor, I look at the speed limit, but I have a lot of people flying by me. Including some DPW trucks today, in anticipation of this meeting, I was ready to like get to road rage and speed up and stop one, but I didn't. So it's a long question, City Administrator. But
so with regard to the question, is it feasible? I would imagine it is, but that's speculation at this point. Knowing that Durfee's coming online and knowing that we have this technology to do this kind of study, I would certainly agree that more information is needed to really understand the best way to create the safest possible environment in that area and also mitigate the speed. I mean, we have maybe less than 1% that's high risk, but, you know, people going 10 plus, what does that look like? Because it's only a 40 mile an hour speed limit, right? This isn't a percentage. This is just a straight 20 or more over is high risk, but that's in a 40. So I'd want to know more about the numbers and try to unpack them, and maybe it's maybe worthwhile, you know, it might be a consultant, it might be somebody we have in-house, but I think we can do a much deeper dive into this. This is phenomenal work within 6 days to respond to this and come prepared with those numbers, but I'd want to learn more about them.
Okay.
But I think
that's
there's
fair
definitely
enough.
An appetite to do that.
Yeah, that's fair enough. But when I hear the 1% number, I trust me, I respect everyone at this table. But I'm sure if you ask the neighbors around there, they would probably find that they wouldn't believe it, that it's that low.
40 miles an hour is really, really fast for for if they're going by your residence, you'd be like, well, they're flying by, you know? Mm-hmm. I think people probably feel that they can speed in that area because there's not a lot of pedestrian traffic.
True.
So they have a false sense of that they can go by there.
Okay.
We're going to keep the traffic trailer out there for, we usually do 30 days at a time, so you get a full gamut of the speed and what's taking place in the neighborhood. Also, whenever we have problems like this, we usually, when people start complaining about the kids speeding or radios and stuff, we usually send a letter over to the schools to remind the kids and educate them the severity if they get a speeding ticket, which is they lose their license, the money that they pay out is astronomical.
Yeah, three times in so many months of year than your habitual traffic offender.
Yep, it's very hefty for junior operators, so.
Okay. Counselor Dion?
So in absence of the trailer, in absence of any time that there is no one deployed there, what, in your opinion, is an effective tool when those two situations don't exist? Or is there not an effective tool?
That's a good question. Traffic has always been the number one problem for the last 100 years of cars coming out, you know? So it's tough. I lived on Brayton Avenue, so I feel ya. I have four small children, and a motorcycle go by, wake one up. So I know exactly what you're talking about. But it's a main thoroughfare with the highway right at the end. So people are, you know, they definitely speed on there. It's probably a lot. It's probably not as fast as we perceive them to be. Mm-hmm. I'm always wow, that car's flying. And then, you know, they're within the mm-hmm. parameters of the speed limit. We would like, everyone would like a police officer on their street, right?
Sure.
So we have to prioritize. Obviously, we all know manpower's, you know, at the bare minimum, and we just try and do our best to prioritize the areas. We have been, the traffic unit's been doing an excellent job with the ATVs. We've been doing quite a bit of work with that. So we just do the best that we can.
Do you feel that the solar-powered speed limit lights and signals are effective?
I think some are. It depends. In this area, I don't think that they would be as visible as, like, the traffic trailer. I'm not even sure where they would put them unless they fix them. We talked about this today.
I don't think there's any way to even determine that, other than to try to make
trial
a guess.
Trial and error?
You know, I mean, unless they provide data, there's no way to, you know, like the captain said, I mean, most people think, you know, cars are operating so very fast, and, you know, until you get out there and do it for a number of years and you begin to, you know, look at a car and say that car's going between 50 and 55 and you throw a LiDAR up on it and you're correct. It's difficult. Like I said, 40 miles an hour is 58 feet per second. If you're standing outside your house, 30 miles per hour is
fast.
And that's why I break it down in feet per second, because we use such a large, you know, 5280 for a mile is a very long distance. But when you say feet per second, it really makes sense. So 40 miles per hour is almost 60 feet per second. That's fast. A car driving or operating at 48 miles per hour is going to seem like it should be, you know, it should be on the highway. But it's just, it's a two-lane divided highway, you know,
it's
two lanes, north and south. And
state, too, as well.
And it's a state road. And, again, maybe there's a thought process that they're a little safer, they can drive a little quicker, or I don't know. I just.
Now, does the state mandate the speed limit on that road? How is that speed limit set?
Well, the city could change it.
Well, that was going to be my next question. So do you think it would be worth lowering the speed limit?
Is that my personal opinion?
I take personal and professional if you want.
I don't think so.
No.
No. No. People will continue to drive on that road
Just because of the nature of the road?
Well, again, it's like the four-way stop, so the stop sign at every intersection. I mean, you know, studies have been shown that the public, they resent it, stopping every 50 feet. I mean, they, you know, now, so you slowed your speed down, but now we have a stop sign problem. Why aren't they stopping at the stop sign? Well, we'll take the stop sign out. Well, now they're speeding. It's, mm-hmm. it's,
And if there's legislation, well, yeah. I'm sorry to interrupt you. Okay. If it's a main thoroughfare, there's some restrictions go along with that, too. I'm sorry.
And that is a valid point. I live in the South End, so from Globe Four Corners to Charles Street, there were 7 sets yes. of lights. And by the time I get to Charles Street, yeah. I'm like, right. why didn't I turn down Slade or one other street? And you're right. It mm-hmm. it does grind on people. Mm-hmm. That's true. With that, I yield.
Thank you, Councilor Dion. May I go this
yes,
way?
Yes, yes.
Yes, Natalie Mello, 510 Northeastern Avenue. I agree with everything. I know you've been there. We've had those machines or those speed things there at least 4 times. I've been there. It's going to be 5 years now, and we've had 3 turnovers right on the corner of New Boston Road and Northeastern Avenue. One at 3 in the morning, maybe a few months ago. My husband had to go out and help the woman. We had to call 911. We thought it was our alarm in our car. Somebody was breaking in. It was somebody there. So that's 3 turnovers, and that was back at 3 in the morning. You talked about 35 miles per hour. This lady, Connie, who's on the corner, New Boston Road and Northeastern Avenue, suggested the same thing, but I don't think that's a good idea. My thing is, I don't think it's going to change. We're hoping it does change, but I see even empty buses, school buses, flying down that street. You can see it. I've seen, I said that already, gas trucks. I don't know if it was Gulf or it was a truck with gas that was going to be delivered, flying down that street. And to me, that is super dangerous. I called Laura's office, find out if they can have those gas trucks going through, because you got houses on both sides. It's residential. Then you've got, yes, those bikes, these guys are doing an amazing job. We haven't heard any bikes or dirt bikes going on in that area at all. It's been amazing. That's the truth. I'm thinking the solar lights, because we talked about that over a year ago, and we were told that they were going to put some on that area. They do have it on Eastern Avenue, and it seems like people slow down with those. I don't know if they still are, because after a while, you're so used to it, you kind of don't see it no more, because it's pretty bad in that section as well. But I'm thinking signage, not enough of signage. I think that's probably the only thing that's going to help us. There's not enough of signage from New Boston Road to Bedford Street, even up to Locust. There's not enough of signage. We need signage there. If nothing else is going to work, then we need signage there. And a lot of people wanted to come tonight, but they couldn't because of the hour and because being today, Thanksgiving week. And they asked if you can do something at St. Anthony of Desert, if you can have a meeting there. This okay. way, everybody's got an input.
We'll be tabling this.
Yeah, so everybody's likely. Got an input. I think a lot of the neighbors understand. I think we all understand. But I personally think, I mean, I'm guilty. Sometimes these new cars, sometimes you are going 40. Before you know, you're going 60. I'm guilty of that. You know what I'm saying? But
high risk.
This, yeah. yes. But we need some kind of signage. I think signage might be a big key over there.
In terms of a speed limit sign, is that what you're talking?
Speed limit signs, you know, whatever. Whatever Laura's got in her office, whatever. Between New Boston Road, too, is a big addict. It seems like everybody in the city of Fall River has to be somewhere yesterday. You know what I'm saying? So it's a problem maybe with the stop signs, too. Nobody pays attention to the stop signs anymore, either. They just go right through. Believe me. And Robeson's another. There's issues everywhere. Somebody was complaining about Highland Avenue, about that turnover the other day. You know? So how do you stop? We need more men on the street. Unfortunately, I know that we have issues. We need more guys out there, guys and women out there. Yes. We need more of them out there because, like this lady Connie was saying, you used to have a police officer there on the corner of New Boston Road and Northeastern Avenue there, you know, with the gun out, checking their speed. And unfortunately, he says, I don't know if they can do that, but there's a lot of elder over there that get really upset. As soon as they hear a crash, they're calling 911. you know, and it's not fair to you guys either. So I don't know what the plan is, but I just want to make sure we're not making this up. There's a problem. I see you there. I see Officer Riley there. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. You know, that does slow them down for a while, but some of these crazy people, not a good thing.
Also, what instead of those solar flashing lights, because I always think about the one on Bedford Street, you kind of don't notice it. It's a little hot, right? But I have seen in some communities, they have those overhead, you know, it's almost like the traffic signal light goes over the street and it has the ginormous sign that says when speeding, when flashing.
That's great idea.
It's like I think that something like that.
Also, those signs that are out there, I talked about that with Talora and Chief Cardoza. If you go to Vermont, you see those signs. But on top of that sign is also a blue light. So it's giving you, like, hey, you're going over the speed limit. So maybe if they had some kind of signage, I think is a big key. Maybe if they had something like that, it might help too. It's the safety for everybody, including yourselves and everybody. You know, it's a problem everywhere. But when you see it day in and day out, and you're kind of like, oh boy, you know, then you got people that live right on the corner of Locust and Northeastern Avenue. It's a drag race sometimes for them, and they can hear this in the house. The house shakes sometimes. So I feel for them, I really do, and so I had to open my big mouth. Huh. All right, sorry.
You feel for everybody tonight. Thanks
for
coming.
I know.
We're approaching 15 minutes, so we have one other man.
Yeah, I just have a quick question. Captain Fasato, you brought up a good point about manpower being an issue. So do you think that having the van there, just the visible, slows down the traffic anyway? Just people seeing is it a unit that people can actually see that device that you have out there?
It's a trailer. The trailer is pretty effective.
So is it something that we can leave out there for a little while we're working on maybe signage or something like that?
It is left up there for 30 days, and then, as you know, because you get the same calls we do, then there's a problem on Marina Street. There's a problem on Plymouth Avenue. There's not enough of them. So there's problems everywhere. So especially with speeding, so we try and hit the.
But that's interesting to know that the trailer itself is effective. So it's probably the signage.
It is effective. Those flashing overhead when flashing, speeding, and they're kind of like right in your face too.
So I yield.
Can I just say one more thing?
Of course.
And also, like Linda was saying, my husband had mentioned about the lights, maybe changing the time of the lights where people are not rushing from one light to the other to try to get the go light, to get the green light to go. So maybe they can switch the times on the lights, you know? Because I know this ain't going to be the last.
Because the Locust, you're talking about Locust to New Boston Road. So the
New Boston Road to Locust Street and Northeastern Avenue.
So to change the time.
On the lights, no matter where, whatever they can do.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? So.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Councilor Furr?
Nope.
Washington.
Nope.
Chief is correct. Oh, Councilor Tia. Wow.
That's all right. How many trailers do we have?
Sorry, Laura.
We have two. One smaller than the. This one takes more data.
They both take the same data. One's an 18 and one is a 24.
Okay. And what's the price of a trailer, more or less? I don't expect an exact dollar amount, but a range. $10,000,
$15,000, $20,000. I can send you an email on that. I don't want to commit to a price and not know it.
I'd appreciate that, because if you really feel that is a very effective tool, and
50%.
part of our problem is we don't have enough trailers, and you have to continue to move it from place to place to place, maybe we should put some ARPA funding into purchasing two more trailers so we can monitor three places at one time instead of only one.
Fantastic.
With the better trailer that takes.
That would help us too, because we get a lot of complaints, so it's hard to say, well, you got to wait 30 days for us to address your issue, so that we know it. And we have to be very frugal with the manpower in the emergency areas, the ATVs took precedence, you know, over the last 6 weeks or so. Well, actually, it's been a long time, but really they amped up at the end of the summer. So they have been really focused on that. And we just, because it's been such a problem, the chief took two officers and brought them back to the motor vehicle unit that had been pulled to supplement uniform division. So they're back, and we are addressing now the traffic concerns.
And so is that something I could put in the form of a motion, that we send something to the administration for, to see if they would consider some ARPA funding for two more trailers?
Sure. We have the city administrator here. I'm sure he's taking notes, and he will, and I'm going to entertain in this.
Yep. I'll make a motion to table for now, if you wish.
A motion to table this, and I think it's been a good meeting thus far. Our professionals, our law enforcement is very aware of it, and I think they get a lot of input from people. And we'll take it up relatively quickly at the next meeting. So, thank you.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
So I'm sure Seth, you'll get that recommendation up to the Mayor Coogan. Thank you. So item number four is a resolution discussion regarding planning. Planned adjustment locations of emergency vehicles.
Thank you.
To reassure residents of the EMS will continue to have equal access to health care in all neighborhoods, referred on 11-8-22. May I have the EMS director come down, whoever's relevant to this issue? And we did hear it through citizens' input that the neighborhood is meeting, and but obviously this resolution is all about
yes, I went to the
time it takes to get
meeting,
to emergency.
I think last week. What was that?
Okay, thank you. Go ahead.
Oh, no, I already went to the Maplewood Association meeting last week. I think it was last Tuesday. Spoke with them. It went well. I explained them the situation. And they seemed fine with it.
Yeah, I spoke with Seth a couple weeks ago. He's going to come to our next neighborhood meeting to discuss this as well. I know Helen has a few things to say. She has a petition that she had went around.
Went to the clerk, please. Thank you.
People are not happy. They're not happy at all. And I think it was an injustice that they never notified the neighborhood that we're going to do this. They should have notified. What we want to know is, where are they? Where did they put these ambulances? Where did they put the ambulances? How long did it take? Isn't it a 3 minute? Is this time for 3 to 4 minutes?
No, that's a fire response for a fire. That's NFPA standard for the fire department. For an EMS response nationwide, the appropriate response time is 8 minutes. That's a national standard, 8 minutes for a medical emergency. Our average response time in the city is 5 minutes, 8 seconds.
We had an incident at October 31st, Halloween night. Took the ambulance 12 minutes to get there. First it was a police, then it was a fire truck, then another fire, another red truck, then another car. The ambulance almost had to park on Warren Street.
Yeah, I would believe that, and you have to understand that. The rescues, 87% of the time, don't even respond from the stations because they're out. So most likely that truck was at the hospital dropping off a patient, and the dispatch calls them, we need someone to clear. Any city rescue can clear. If you listen to the scanner, you'll hear it all the time. They drop their patient off, they make their stretcher, and they take off. You'll see delays like that. And if no one can clear, you'll be getting mutual aid, whether it's from Somerset, Tiverton, or Westport. In that case, we have a squad that can respond in lieu of the ambulance. That's not a transporting ambulance, but it's actually a class 5 ambulance, so it has everything the ambulance has, so the paramedic can actually treat the patient as if the ambulance was there. It's just a delay in the transport unit getting there. If there's any delays with our response, it's because our trucks are tied up. It's not because they're not in a specific area. But that's usually our average response time is 5 minutes. I could tell you since this morning, to me just getting here today, rescues responded to 46 calls with 7 rescues. That was 10 hours of service. And on an average day, we picked, just picked a day at random. November 1st responded to 150 calls for service in 24 hours with 6 rescues. So if you break it down in the quarter, for the first quarter of the year, we did 6,195 calls in 3 months. Our trucks are busy. In 24 hours, any given truck could do 22 calls in a 24-hour period. And keep in mind, in that time frame, they have to document every single call. Everything has to get documented. They're given, for routine calls, we give them 15 minutes, which is almost an injustice, but we're busy, and they get used to it. And for high acuity calls, they get 45 minutes. And I can tell you that 99% of the time, they don't even get to finish their reports. They go home, and they finish them at home on a mobile app because they don't have time when they're on duty to finish their run sheets. But we're very busy. And as for, you know, the squad, and we do have a Rescue 7 that covers the city and also does non-emergency stuff out of Stewart Hospital, but they also back up the city. And in 2 weeks, we'll be having an 8th rescue come up. That's going to be like a Rescue 7 that's going to cover the city and do non-emergency stuff. So we'll actually have 8 rescues in service 3 days a week and 7 rescues in service the rest of the week. That's more than the city of Providence.
How many ambulances does the city have?
We run 7 rescues right now.
7?
The rescues are the ambulances.
And from what I understand, Tiverton is our backup?
Mutual Aid is Tiverton, Somerset, and Westport.
They only
and
have
Freetown.
2 ambulances. So if
Correct.
We can't get an ambulance in Fall River and Tiverton is busy, what happens?
Then they try to get one of our rescues to clear. That's all you can do. You'll wait. It's unfortunate, but it's
we'd like
you'll,
to
you'll
have
see it.
The ambulance put back at Candace.
You'll see it.
This is what the neighbors want. This is what the neighborhood wants. We need it. I think it should be put back where it was.
So,
thanks for coming, Mr. Rico. I think you made your point, and this most likely is going to be tabled as well. But. And there's a meeting, right? A neighborhood meeting that's going to occur?
That's what I was going to say. If there's any neighborhood association that would like the administration to come along with Chief Oliveira and discuss this, we're glad to do it. I think one of the most concerning parts about some of the folks that seem really, really upset about this is that the basis for their response is not based on fact. It's based on speculation. And so if you speculate that ambulances are always leaving from a firehouse to respond to a call, okay, well, then the ambulance moves, and obviously that's going to change the response time, but that's not the case. The case is almost 90%, 87% of the time, the ambulance who responds to your call is either coming from the hospital or coming from its past call because they are just, the operational tempo is just so extreme. And so, you know, then we, you know, if we want to sort of shift the concern to, okay, are we equipped to meet the operational tempo, as opposed to are we locating ambulances in the right place? Because that doesn't really matter as much as are we responding by the standard. The answer is we are. We're responding almost 3 minutes faster than the national standard. And two, Chief Oliveira, along with the support of Chief St. Martin, has done an exceptional job over the last several years, especially over the last year, trying to add rescues, trying to add resources, trying to add personnel, increase pay, like do any number of things in order to make that service more robust in the city, and they've done exactly that.
Yeah, and the administration has pushed that big time. Yeah, I agree. Council Dion?
So how many fire stations that used to have ambulances are not going to have ambulances now?
It will be the Candace Station and Stanley Street, which has never had a rescue in it. There's no space.
So the only change is Candace?
No. Rescue 7 was at the Globe. Mm-hmm. They're going to the center. Rescue 8 will be there. Squad 11 was at the North Station. They're going to the center station. EMS 7 is our secondary supervisor vehicle. They're going to the center station also.
And that doesn't leave those stations with no ambulances?
No, Rescue 5 will still be at the north end. Rescue 2 is at the Flint. Rescue 3 will remain at the Globe as it's been. That's basically, since I've been here, that's how it was set up.
Okay. I'll tell you where my concerns lie. So I believe, and I could be incorrect, and I know you'll correct me if I am. So if someone is in cardiac arrest, every extra minute it takes to get to that person reduces their chance of survival by 20%. Is that correct?
I don't know that fact. I couldn't quote it, but I would say you're pretty close.
Mm-hmm. So from Central Station to Candeias, how long does it take to get from Central Station to Candeias?
I wouldn't even know. I would say about 2 minutes.
About 2 minutes. So you just reduced the survival rate of someone in cardiac arrest by 40%.
No. If a cardiac arrest comes in, an engine company is dispatched immediately, which they're trained as. Some are EMTs, some are first responders, they have AEDs. So it's not so much when the ambulance gets there, it's when a first responder gets there. So if the first responder, if there's a cardiac arrest on Moss Street, and Engine 4 responds, and they're there within 2 minutes with an AED and CPR, that is not a delay in response, because it's a tandem response. You know, 87% of the time, the rescue's not going to be in the station. We can't guarantee that there's an ambulance in the station, and that's going to respond with the prior to the engine company, and they'll get there and start. It's BLS, basic life support, before ALS.
Mm-hmm.
You need first responders, even police officers, mm-hmm. right? The first responders, they'll start CPR, they'll get the AED on, and then the paramedics come in, and then they start the advanced treatment. So there's really no delay in treatment. It's just at different levels.
And transporting is important as well. So what's the logic, and why is there not going to be an ambulance base at Candeias? What's the reasoning or logic behind that?
So the logic is to bring everything that is not on the outskirts centrally located.
But yet you're going to have one at every other station. That's I think that's what people are having a hard time.
On the outlying areas.
I'm not, you know, I shouldn't be speaking for other people, but I think that's something that people are having a hard time wrapping their minds around.
The fact that they're the only station
without an ambulance.
On the cover, yeah, it looks like, yes, everyone on the outside has an ambulance and no one else has. The Candeias station didn't have a rescue in it from prior to my time here till 2016. And I could tell you from personal experience, I worked the Globe station for 15 years. I covered the Maplewood area in my rescue. And I never noticed us having a delay in a response. And then I worked the Central Station for 5 years, never had a delay in response. Our delays were we were dropping off patients and responding from the hospitals. Very rare was I sitting in the station. You know, maybe a Sunday afternoon, the Patriots are on, everything calms down. Once the game's over.
Maybe in the middle of the night.
Yeah, it picks up, you know. The quiet mm-hmm. time, say between 3 and 5 a.m., yeah, there's a quiet time.
And believe me, I know you're busy. I have a scanner,
I
listen to it. It's on 24 hours a day.
Believe me.
There's no doubt that.
But
that
from my personal experience working in the street and trying to coordinate the organization with the responses, I don't see any delay in responses, especially when we're working in tandem with the fire and police departments, their first responders. If there's an emergency, you're going to get care. It's about the rescuer getting there. The transport with paramedics will bring everything that the ER has to you,
mm-hmm.
that an ER doc and a nurse can do in the ER.
Mm-hmm.
But it's got to start with the BLS stuff first, even if the paramedic gets there. We're going to start with basic stuff, and then we're going to move on to the advanced stuff if it's needed and if it's not. So our fire departments and police departments do an excellent job with their initial responses when it comes to CPR, giving people oxygen, letting us know what's going on prior to the arrival. They're very capable of doing that, and they're very good at it. So I think as a team, I think we're good. We look at the response times constantly. If I noticed that there was an issue, I would absolutely revert it back to where it was.
What would be the harm in leaving it the way it was? It's only one vehicle. You're still moving a fair number of vehicles to the central station. What would be the harm in leaving it status quo?
So there's an additional personnel issue that I can't speak to. I can certainly share that with you offline as a city councilor, but there's a private issue that goes into this that the administration, along with Chief Oliveira, felt was important enough to address. And this plan, as part of the reorg, was a way to address it. But it's a personnel issue, and I can't get into it. And I apologize for that.
Well, with that, I'll yield for now. Thank
now,
you.
Let me just say, if by doing it this way we had affected response time, I would choose response time over the personnel problem, all right, all day long. So even if they're, whether it's a personality thing or any of the other things that could be a personnel issue, if that affected response time, we would say, you know what, we're going to have to deal with this some other way. But it didn't, and so therefore, this is how we're doing it.
I guess, obviously, I don't know the situation. So, I mean, when I hear it, I could totally change my mind. But my knee-jerk reaction is, if it's a personnel problem, get rid of the personnel and keep the ambulance and get somebody who's not a problem. But I don't know what the problem is.
With respect, I think this whole thing is a knee-jerk reaction. I think we actually need to look at the statistics, look at the data. Mm-hmm. I certainly understand people's concerns. The problem is the concerns are not based upon data. They're based upon impressions. Mm-hmm. And the problem with impressions is that, you know, we don't necessarily know if they're supported by the facts. And so Chief Oliveira has looked at this very closely. Chief St. Martin has looked at this very closely with him. The administration has looked at this very closely. And we don't believe that there is any risk to the public safety that this poses. And I think one of the important things to note is that because there was some construction being done at Candeias, the rescue that was at Candeias was actually down at Globe for how many weeks? So before there was any talk of moving anyone anywhere, that rescue had already been displaced and was responding out of Globe without anyone noticing any sort of reduction in service or response time. Because it just happened, there just wasn't, you know, the facility for it because of construction work being done. So that, to me, bears out what Chief Oliveira, who I trust implicitly already, is telling me, that we've had this rescue operating out of Globe as opposed to Candeias, just a, you know, facilities issue. And it's been doing its work at the same level of excellence that the Fall River EMS, I think, has allowed the residents of Fall River to become accustomed to.
That I yield.
Thank you. It's a work in progress, so I'll entertain a motion.
Motion table.
One question. So what can the neighbors do to try to get this back into the Candeias?
Well, there will be a neighborhood meeting, Ms. Rego, and we're past the allotted time here, so. There was a motion to table?
Well, motion to table to continue the discussion.
Want a second there?
Second.
All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Motion adjourned. Well, it was a motion. Second.
Oh, motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn. Second.